They say these chains will never break, but they don't know you like we do. There is power in your name. We've heard that there is no way through. We've heard the tide will never change. They haven't seen what you can do. There is power in your name. So much power in your name. Move the immovable, break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. From
you said, I believe. You said, it is done. You said, I believe. You said, it is done. Can you help me sing?
You said, I believe. You said, it is done. You said, I believe. You
is this: fulfilling ancient prophecy, arriving as a king, but riding on a donkey, about to turn Jerusalem upside down. Who is this? Hero of the people, friend of sinners, mentor of fishermen, and dignifier of women, welcoming children, tax collectors, and the poor, healing blind eyes and broken lives. Who is this? Commanding the wind and waves, before whom demons tremble and sickness is obliterated. A radical rabbi sparking controversy in every conversation. Rumors of his teaching spreading from town to town. This is he. Who rulers try to assassinate, haters try to complicate, leaders try to dominate, but no one could eradicate. This is he who makes all things new, sets captives free, brings peace and truth, teaches blessed are the poor. And our response? Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the Son of David. Palms raised, branches wave, shouts of praise. Save us, Jesus. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Amen. Good morning. Arise and let's worship. Hosanna in the highest this morning. Amen. Well, I trust you're so glad to be here on this Palm Sunday. Look at your neighbor and say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. We worship you today, Jesus. Lord, we magnify you. May you be glorified in this place. As he came into Jerusalem, let's welcome him here today, church. Amen.
Hearts are yearning for He is Hosanna. Hosanna, the Bible says, is the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And Hosanna is the highest. How many knows there is no name higher, no name greater, no name that's got more power than the name of Jesus? And we're here to celebrate his triumphal entry as he come riding on a donkey into Jerusalem. And they would lay down the palm leaves and they laid their clothes down before him, set those clothes on that donkey's back, and he rode into Jerusalem. But you know what's interesting about that is that at that time, Pastor, they were thinking that he was there to save them right then. But what they didn't know was he come meek and lowly in heart. The Bible says he came in the form of a servant. He humbled himself. He came in like fashion, like you and I, meek and lowly in heart, rode that donkey through Jerusalem because he knew that in a few days he was going to be heading to the cross. And I want you to know, you ought to be thankful today that there was a cross that Jesus chose to hang himself on. He allowed them to kill him. He allowed them to crucify him, so that there would be an atonement made for our sins. I'm so thankful, aren't you, that our Savior came to save us from our sins. Thank you, Jesus. You can be seated. We welcome you here on this Palm Sunday. It's so good to see everybody out and smiles on your face. It's so good to have the Tillery family with us here this morning. And look at this young handsome man here on the front right here, huh? He is handsome. We appreciate all of our family that is here today. Once you have been a part of our church, we consider you our family today. And so we want to welcome you, and we ask that you would just take a few moments that, you know, to understand the true meaning of Palm Sunday is that, remember, Hosanna, we say it, we sing it, but it literally means the Lord saves. And I am so thankful for his salvation plan, aren't you? All right, today is going to be our Youth Sunday. And we also have Pastor John here, who has been doing such a tremendous job. Amen. He is a servant of God. He serves under the pastors. He loves the Lord. We love you, Pastor John. We appreciate you for everything you do for the youth and for what you do under Pastor Kevin. And he is going to be bringing the word today. He wants to remind all the youth here today, if you're from ages 6 through 12, grades. What did I say, ages? Sorry. Grades 6 through 12. That you are to stay after the service. There will be a special gathering time of Bible study and hamburgers on the grill, right? And so that's always a good thing when there is some physical food, but spiritual food will be given out as well. This coming Wednesday on March the 27th, we will have another Reducing the Risk class. And that will also, that training will be led by Pastor Amanda. And so if you have not taken the Reducing the Risk class and you are working or wanting to work with the youth, it is required that you take this class. There is a sign-up sheet there in the foyer, and we would ask that you would sign up, please. So if you weren't able to go to the first one, you can sign up for this one on that day. Next Sunday is Easter. A lot of the world says it's Easter. We think about food. We think about Easter egg hunting. We think about all these other things. But let's put our hearts and our mind that next week represents the glorious resurrection of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. That's what Easter is about. It's about the resurrected one. Amen? And I would like for you to please take a moment to, if you haven't picked up one of these brochure cards here where it says Easter changes everything. It is an invitational brochure card. We would ask that you would take one of those and you would find somebody, whether it's at work or your neighborhood or whoever you feel that God leads on your heart, put this in their hands and personally invite them to come out next week for our Easter service. We ask that you would do that, and God will fill this house not just with His presence, with this, fill this house with those who need this resurrected Lord in their lives. Amen? Okay, so there also is going to be a special dance presentation. The drama team will be coming up with a special dance presentation. You don't want to miss that. Amen? So get excited about that. Bring somebody out for that as well. Our pastor will be bringing next week the word on how Jesus changes everything. Look at your neighbor and say, Jesus changes everything for our good. Amen. And so we're so thankful for our pastor for bringing that word to us. So set your alarms early, get here early, and be ready to worship with us our risen Savior. Also coming in the month of April, starting Wednesday, April 10th, and it will be at 6:30 p.m., we will be starting our Wednesday night Bible study on living the Christian life and having personal evangelism. And on April the 28th, we will be having our Friends and Our Family Day. Another opportunity for you to invite your friends and your family for this day. And we would just ask that you would please bring us to you, because we love eating. How many know that everybody loves eating, don't we, Sister Linda? And so we love to eat. We love to eat at Graham. We love to eat at the church, too. So anyway, bring your favorite dish, and we're going to have a celebration time with our friends and with our family. Remember, we want to get them here, because unless they're here, God can't transform lives, right? Bring them here and let God do a mighty work in their life. I thank you for your attention. We're going to go right back into our worship, and we appreciate you being here. God bless you.
Amen. Let's stand back up. How many is thankful that God loves you? Amen. We're going to sing a song that says, "For God so loved the world." You know that song, the verse. Everybody should know it. John 3:16, it said, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son." Say it with me. "That whoever believes in Him would not perish but have everlasting life." I'm so glad that God loves us this morning. Amen. Come on, church. Are you glad that God loves us? He didn't just die, Lord, for the rich. He died for all of us, the young, the old.
Yeah.
How many is thankful for the blood of Jesus this morning? Church, do you realize that without Him we are nothing? Without Him we are sinners. We are lost. But the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sins today. Are you thankful for the blood of Jesus this morning?
Amen.
Amen. Let's just worship Him this morning. Give Him a praise. Hallelujah. Lord, we love You, Jesus. Lord, we can never make it without You. There's no way to heaven except through the blood of Jesus. Thank You, Lord. Hallelujah.
I was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated.
Sing that last line.
You called me from.
thankful for the blood of Jesus this morning? How many thank you that you have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb? Amen.
Hallelujah.
We're going to prepare our hearts this morning for communion. Communion is a very special time. The Bible is plain in 1 Corinthians that when we participate in the Lord's Supper, the Bible says, as often as you do this, you bring this in remembrance of me, of what I did prior to going to the cross at that whipping post and taking those stripes on his back for our healing. And then second of all, walking up Golgotha's hill as they nailed him to the cross for the sins of mankind, for your sins and for my sins. And so this morning, we're going to do that in remembrance of him. This Palm Sunday, we're going to remember what Christ did over 2,000 years ago. And if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior this morning, this is a good time. This is a good time to give your life to Christ. If you need healing in your body this morning, this is a good time to believe that Christ is our healer. Can you say amen? How many of you know that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forevermore? If he healed then, he will heal now. How many are standing in this congregation this morning and saying, Christ is my healer, that I have been healed, that I've prayed before and Christ has healed me? If you need healing in your family this morning, if you need healing in your emotions this morning, if you need healing anywhere in your body, Christ is the healer. I'm going to give a real quick testimony because I want to build your faith before we take the bread this morning and participate in the juice. About 6 weeks ago, I got a call from the doctor, and I won't say much about that, but a little bit later that week, I started feeling horrible. I actually felt like I'd had COVID again. I didn't have no energy whatsoever in my body. I remember about 4 Sundays ago getting ready to come to the church, and I had already prepared my sermon and couldn't even hardly get out of the chair. And a couple pastor friends of mine and my wife and a couple family members had been praying for me. And I stand today feeling better than I have felt in a long time, because I know that Christ come down and touched me. And if you're here this morning and you need healing, we're going to believe by faith that when we take this bread this morning, that God is going to reach out and God's going to heal you. No matter what it is, I stand as a testimony through prayer that Christ is our healer this morning. Amen. As you prepare the bread this morning, we'll give you just a minute to prepare and get the bread out. I want to read the passage of Scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and it says, it's the institution of the Lord's Supper. It says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on that same night in which he was betrayed, he took the bread and he gave thanks." Let's take a moment this morning. Let's give thanks. Father, we thank you. God, we don't want to run by this moment real quick just to, Lord, say it was just a little part in the service. We're claiming our healing right now, from the top of our head to the soles of our feet. Our emotional part of our life, we thank you for healing it. For our body, we thank you for healing it. And God, we claim it right now. And as the saints of God, in Jesus' name, as we partake in the bread, as you eat of the bread this morning, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for your healing power this morning. We thank you, God, as that bread goes in our body. God, we're believing people that have back pain this morning is being healed in Jesus' name. People that have heart troubles being healed in Jesus' name. People that have trouble with their liver, their kidneys. God, any part of their body right now. People that may be fighting with fibro, joint pain. God, right now, they're healed in Jesus' name. Father, we take the juice this morning. Father, the word is very clear. In this same manner also they took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant of my blood. Father, thank you for salvation. Thank you for salvation as we all take the juice together. Let's sing this old hymn as Tina continually plays this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Let's lift our hands up this morning and thank you for the bread, Lord, and thank you for the cup this morning. Let's sing it out loud. Come on, church. Let's sing it real loud. Let's sing it out loud.
I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross.
Jesus said one of them fell like lightning. He saw Satan fall like lightning. He had instruments on the inside of him, and he could sing better than anybody you know. But instead of worship coming through him, he wanted worship to come to him. See, God had to kick him out because nobody can handle worship but the living God. Nobody is worthy of worship but the living God. And the reason the enemy hates us so much is because you and I get to worship God out of choice. He failed once and got kicked out. We all fail. And the thing is, God still wants to hear from us. Can we give God a big praise as you all get seated? God still wants to hear from us. You all may be seated. Can we give the worship team a big hand? We are glad. Oh, man, I was three people. Can we give the worship team a big hand? We are glad you are here today. I'm glad you're here today on this Palm Sunday. It's a special Sunday for Christ followers. And I want to talk to you today about rhythm. How many of you would say that you have rhythm? Okay, one person. And that was a half a hand. Right? I get it. If your hand's all the way up, you probably got rhythm, right? If your hand's not down, you probably don't got rhythm. If you're like Brother Wayne, you're kind of like in the middle, you probably don't have rhythm, right? You're like, maybe so. I don't know. Maybe see him on the dance floor. Who knows? Oh, the shoulder. That's what it was. That's what it was. That's too much dancing. That's what it was. So there are so many things in life that have rhythm, right? We all have rhythm, but we have rhythm in different places. Some people play the drums like Daryl. Some people play the piano like Tina. My kids just beat and bang on things. It is beat and bang. If you got kids, you know what I'm talking about. It is beat and bang on things, right? Some like to dance. And that itself takes rhythm, right? If you play sports like Jill in softball, it takes rhythm. You get the ball hit to you, you swoop down, pick it up, and throw it to the base. It takes a certain rhythm, right? Levi has started T-ball. And that takes rhythm, but a three-year-old playing T-ball or learning to play T-ball is kind of funny, right? I'm teaching him the rhythm, the basics of it. I want him to swing the bat, hit the ball, drop the bat, and run the first. That's all I want him to do. Hit the ball, drop the bat, run to first. It has a rhythm to that. It doesn't just happen. There's a flow in that. Swimming, like Quinn, it takes rhythm, right? If you don't have rhythm, you'll get very tired very quickly and you'll probably drown, right? Walking takes rhythm. Some people can't do that. Some people can't walk and chew gum at the same time. They're like that. It takes rhythm to walk and do things. Everything in life has rhythm. You have your own rhythm. Maybe when you're writing cursive, you got a rhythm to that. Mine is just chicken scratching. I stop halfway and then I keep going. What about typing? Typing, it takes rhythm. Even our Christian walk has a rhythm to it. There's a beat that we go off of as a Christ follower, right, Pastor Steve? How do we stay in rhythm as a Christ follower? I've been married for 11 years. Thank God she put up with me that long. I have an 8-year-old daughter. I have a 3-year-old son. I'm a volunteer here at the church, and I have a full-time job. But one thing I found out is when I'm on rhythm with my Christ life, my relationships and what I'm doing is really, really good. Not perfect, but it's on rhythm. It's really, really good. But the problem in any area of my life is whenever I get off of rhythm with my Christ life, things start to fall apart. Things start to not go as planned. Start losing my temper, maybe. If I have my Christ life good, everything seems to just fall in place. Not perfect rhythm, but rhythm. Not perfect, but everything just seems to fall in place. Matthew 6:33 says, "But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." So how can you and I be able to stay on rhythm as a Christ follower? I want to talk about a 3-step rhythm. 1, 2, 3. Everybody do this. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. A 3-step rhythm is just that easy. First step is invitation. Every invitation is just an opportunity, a blessing. Right? Do you have an invitation to have an opportunity to go to college? Blessing. Right there. If you have an opportunity to go to college, boom, it's a blessing. There are invitations that are all over us. And if I accept those invitations, I'm also accepting the blessing that comes with it, right? That's why when God gives us an invitation, it only has a blessing attached to it. Because the Bible says that He is a good, good Father. So for Him to invite us into something negative would be opposite of His character. Right? So every invitation that we receive from God, we should want to be a part of. I want to be a part of it. Every invitation from God, I want to be a part of it. Think of salvation, right? We got the invitation of Jesus, right? That is a blessing because as soon as I made that prayer and believed in my heart and confessed with my mouth, my life completely changed. My life completely changed. I didn't have to go get right first and then do that. No, as soon as I believed in my heart, my life completely changed because of the invitation that He has given me. Part of John 10:10 says, I came that they may have life and they may have it abundantly. Right? We can get daily invitations to do something, but what are we doing with the invitation? If you were here last month, I talked about Revelation 3:20. It says, here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. You see, God is a gentleman, right? He's not going to barge His way into anything. He's not going to barge His way into your life. He's not going to barge His way into my life. See, if God barged His way into your life, He would be what? He would be abusive. And He's not an abusive God. He's a God. He's a God of love, patience, kindness. The Bible says He is knocking at the door of your heart. He's knocking on the door of my heart. God says, I don't want to barge in because He's about relationship. I want to be invited, He says. He's inviting you and I to have a relationship with Him and for us to sit down and just do life together. Life's hard. We have challenges. We have trials. We have hiccups. We have screw-ups. He just wants us to sit down and do life with Him together. But the only way for us to do that is if we accept His invitation. The invitation is an opportunity for us to go to the next level. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, we go from glory to glory. We're going to the next level. This is what happens when I accept His invitation. We go from this level of joy to the next level of joy, right? This level of resources to the next level of resources. This level of obedience to the next level of obedience. See, there's power in an invitation, right? There's power in an invitation. Imagine, if you will, all of us in here, the church paid for tickets for you to go to your favorite concert, right? Not going to be expensive tickets because it's Pastor Kevin, but you got tickets to go to your favorite concert, all right? You get ready, you go there, you got your ticket in hand, you get there at the door, hand the person your ticket, and say, wait a minute. Wow, you got VIP access. You can go behind the stage, before the concert, and you get to hang out with them after the concert. You're thinking, no, wait a minute. This is the ticket that Calvary Assembly of God bought. This is the nosebleed tickets. Remember, Pastor Kevin, if he bought it, this is going to be the nosebleed tickets. I think you got it wrong. You might want to look at this ticket again. Right? This ain't right. Them things are expensive. Calvary Assembly of God bought me this ticket. Nosebleed tickets here, right? But it's not because you bought these VIP tickets. It's because someone else gave you an invitation. See, they said if you take this VIP ticket, you'll be able to experience things that the ticket that you currently have in your hand, it would never get you. God said, if you take my invitation, you'll be able to do things that you never thought you could be able to do. Compared to the lifestyle that you're living right now. If God gives you this invitation, it's much better. It's priceless. I mean, he gave his life for that. You'll be able to see things, experience things, hear things, do things never imaginable. See, that's what God wants to do in your life, and that's what God wants to do in my life. If he said, if you accept an invitation that I give you, I will be able to give you an experience, and you will walk different, talk different, see things different, think different, behave different, grow different. You'll do everything different. But everything will be different, but I have to accept his invitation. There is a saying that I heard of, God honors honor and God honors effort. God says, I love you so much, but I want you to put skin in the game. When you're playing sports, I want you to put skin in the game. I want you to give it all. Because if I don't put skin in the game, I don't value it as much. And if I don't put skin in the game, I won't value it as much. The good thing is everyone is invited with Jesus. That's what the Great Commission says, right? When Jesus was leaving, the disciples were like, what are we going to do now? Jesus says in Matthew 28:19, therefore go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Tell everyone. If God isn't giving invitations for everybody else, then he's certainly inviting you and I to certain places as well. The world, when it says go into the world, does it mean you have to go across the country? You can go in the world that you live in right now. Your next door, your school, whoever at the grocery store. That is your world. Whoever is around you, tell them what God has done in your life. But what I have to do is listen for the door knock, right? I have to pay attention to see if he is getting my attention. I have to pay attention. We all have distractions, right? Okay, nobody's got distractions but me. I have distractions all over my life. I mean, I'm distracted right now. People are fanning themselves with the... I mean, it's cool, but it's just... We all have distractions, right? Jesus chose a particular people, Pastor Steve, to be part of his 12. He chose fishermen, tax collectors, thieves. And if he can use them, he certainly can use you and I, right? If he gave them an invitation, he can give me an invitation. If he gave it to them, he can give it to me. See, look at me. I know what it is to mess up. I am far from perfect. I know what it is to know better, but not do better, right? I know what it is to know better, but not do better, but I still get an invitation. I still get an invitation. Am I worthy of it? Absolutely not. But I still get an invitation. How I get the blessing is that I have to accept the invitation. See, we all have an invitation with Jesus. The next step to the three-step rhythm, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, is direction. Direction. How many of you like me don't do good with directions? Directionally challenged, right? You don't know where you're going, I use a GPS. Wife says, well, go out the way you came back in. That still does nothing to me. I am directionally challenged. So we all sometimes need direction. If you're good with directions, that's great. I don't want to see your hand up. That's great. Good. Cool. Awesome. But I am directionally challenged. But what good is it for me to have an opportunity and not know what to do with it? We have an invitation. Now what? We have a direction. Okay, you tell me direction. Now, we have an invitation to accept Jesus into our heart. Now, what do I do? I don't know. What if somebody said, I don't know, just go figure it out. Open the Bible up and read Matthew and start there. What if somebody told you that if you immediately accepted Christ for the first time, now what do? I don't know, just open the Bible up and read. They're opening Genesis up or Revelations up and it's scaring the living daylights out of them. They don't know what to do. We got to give them direction. Or, hey, do you want this job? Sure. How do I do it? I don't know. Figure it out. You're on your own. Fill an application out and hopefully they'll like you. Or, do you want to be able to know how to get into the best college? Figure it out on your own. Direction. We need direction. God doesn't want us to go through that and go through life by ourselves. He wants us to help us and He wants us to give us direction. The people up here on stage, they got an invitation to be able to be on the worship team, right? But they really aren't allowed to play whatever they wanted on Sunday mornings, right? They had to follow the direction of Tina in order to be able to make sure that they're all playing the same song, right? They're all on the same rhythm. There we go. They're all on the same rhythm. And are you like me? Maybe not. You ever see Daryl's not here, but he's back there playing the drums and he's got little things in his ears. You ever worried of what he's listening to? Anybody like me, or am I the only one up there trying to worship and saying, man, what is he listening to? So I'm the only one. Man, like I got one person that's got wondering what in the world is Daryl listening to. So I had a conversation with him. I said, man, what do you listen to when you're playing the drums? He is listening to himself play. So he can make sure he has the opportunity to listen to people singing. He has the opportunity to listen to the keyboard play, but he doesn't do that. He listens to himself so he can stay on rhythm. It's important because he needs to make sure that he is going in the same direction as everyone else when it comes to playing the music. He's not on YouTube listening to something. He is playing and listening to himself play so we can stay on rhythm. It's like a click track. Some musicians listen to click tracks, right? And they help the musicians stay on rhythm. We're gonna play a quick 10-second, 20-second clip of this click track. Boring, isn't it? Mundane. It's help you to stay on rhythm. Oh, this is a click track. Click, click, click. You can speed it up. You can slow it down. It helps musicians stay on rhythm. The Holy Spirit is yours and my click track for life. And it gives us a specific speed and direction to what's coming. Some click tracks tell you what's about to come up. They'll tell you the verse one or somebody. They'll tell you what's about to come up so they can get ready and stay on rhythm. Do you ever wonder what your future holds? Younger, I mean, have you ever thought about that? What am I going to do in my future life? You ever thought about that? Yeah, one. Well, I never did. So you need to be thinking about what your future holds, right? The Holy Spirit gives us the direction that we need and helps us to stay on rhythm. Not perfect rhythm, but rhythm. One, two, three. One, two, three. We got the invitation. We got the direction. John 14:26 says, "But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you." Has anybody in here felt convicted? Okay, right, I'm going to turn around for the ones that didn't raise their hands. I'm going to ask again, has any of you all felt convicted before? Right? You did something. You said something. You posted something. Something happens. The thing is, something happens on the inside of you and you feel like that, man, I got them good, didn't I? You should be happy about it, right? But now you're feeling kind of bad. God, maybe I shouldn't have. I told them. Oh, man, I probably shouldn't have said that. I got them this time, boy. They never said nothing when I said that. They just walked away. Who knows that the Holy Spirit, you might not like it sometimes. Kind of lays it on pretty thick. Even when no one else knew you did it or said it or posted it. Quickly took it down. You might not like that voice, and it might not be the fun thing. But hear me out. If you don't remember anything today, hear this. But the scary thing is not when you hear that voice, but when that voice shuts off in your life. And you might ask yourself, how in the world does a voice just shut off? Does God just disappear? Does he just go away? Remember, God is a gentleman and God is a good steward. The more I listen to his voice, accept his invitation, and then listen to the direction of the Holy Spirit, that voice only continues to get louder in my life. It gets louder in my life. It helps me be able to say, you shouldn't do this. You shouldn't say that. You should hold up. Wait a minute. Think about what you're getting ready to do. How is this going to make you feel? And it helps me to stay on rhythm. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. The moment that I stop listening to the direction of the Holy Spirit, that volume just went from 30 to 29. Do a little more, 28, 27, 26, 25, 24, 23. Where you can just barely hear it at that point. You're just living life. You can barely hear it. And we may ask God, why are you getting quiet? But when the reality is, I just stopped obeying. I'm doing my own thing. I'm hyping my own self up. It's okay. You're not perfect. You'll be okay. And just keep doing it. And that voice, next thing you know it, you have no conviction whatsoever. The job of the Holy Spirit is to keep us on God's rhythm. Romans 8:14 says, those who are led by God's Spirit are God's children. Notice the word Spirit, right? It's singular. And the word children is what? Plural, right? There is one rhythm, but multiple instruments. They're all doing the same thing, but just a little bit different. But the one thing is, they're all staying together on rhythm. One, two, three. One, two, three. The third part, and the last part of our three-step rhythm is celebration. So we got our invitation. Invitation from what God wants to do in my life and in your life. I'm not sure what that invitation looks like for you. We have that invitation, and then now we have the direction. And now we get to celebrate. Who all likes a good party, right? We're getting ready to have a party after church. We're going to hang out, grill cheeseburgers, but you can't come unless you're 6th through 12th grade, all right? If you're young at heart, maybe, I'll let you. But we're getting ready to have a party and hang out and chill. Learn about the Bible a little bit. But my celebration is not based on an event, if they like me or not, if I got the job I wanted. The job I have now, that was my goal. But my celebration isn't based upon that. Or if I got to play a sport in school, if I got accepted into the college that I really wanted. My celebration isn't based on those series of events. My celebration is founded in Jesus. And Jesus only. And the only way I get to celebrate is if I have to answer the invitation. And I have to walk out in His direction. Now, then at that point, you can celebrate of what He's giving you the opportunity to do, even though we don't deserve it. Celebrate of Him giving us the direction so we can know where to go in life next. Because who knows, when you get lost, it's kind of scary, right? Not knowing what to do, it's kind of nerve-wracking. The more I stayed on that three-step rhythm, things started falling in line. Not perfect, but they started falling in line. I found myself not working as hard, but I'm still getting the blessings that God wants for my life. The speed of my obedience determines the speed of my advance. So how fast I'm obedient to God and not just putting it off on the back burner determines on how fast I get my blessing, on how fast I'm doing what He wants me to do. Every step I take determines how fast I am obedient. I get the direction from the Holy Spirit. Then I get to celebrate. See, we all celebrated the band playing the same rhythm, didn't we? Right? Because we all what? All were singing. We were all singing, right? The worship team all sang the exact same song. They weren't up here playing 5 different songs. That'd be chaotic, wouldn't it? Trying to figure out which one you're going to praise to, and you're going to dance, you're going to jump, you're going to throw your hands up. You know, they didn't play 5 different songs. They were all on rhythm. They all sang in unity. Everyone in here is different. But we all have the same exact spirit. The same exact spirit that raised Christ up from the dead is living in you and me. But we have to accept that invitation. Our celebration comes because we get to experience the reality of God by staying on rhythm. The Holy Spirit is there to help us get back on the rhythm when we get knocked off. How many of you all have got knocked off rhythm in your life? Right? Who knows the story of the prodigal son in Luke 15? As the worship team comes up, if you don't know, we can give a short story of it. There was this man who had 2 sons. And this man was wealthy. I mean, he had it all. He was Jack. I guess y'all would say it. Jack, stacked, whatever. He had the money. He could do it all, right? He had 2 sons. He was going to give their inheritance to them. One son decided, I'm going to take my inheritance. I'm going to go out and I'm going to adult early. How many of you all adulted early when you were younger? Thought you had it all. Went out and adulted early. All of his inheritance. He had all the money. Everything you could think of. He went out and blew it all. blew every single last dime of it. Sitting out there, no work, no money, nothing. Started working. He was out with the pigs, so to say. What they were eating started looking good to him. He was down to his lowest. He had the rhythm while he was home. He went off and tried to do his own thing. And he wanted to come back home. He thought, man, if I could just go back home and be a helper in my father's house, it would be better living than what I'm doing now. According to that culture, that's not what he's supposed to be doing. So he decided to come back home. And it said in the Bible, the father was there pretty much waiting with arms open wide. And he said, get him a robe. Get him a ring on his finger. Let's celebrate. My son has came back home. He came back on rhythm. Father didn't say, now you're back. You got nothing to show for. You went out, did that. Now look at you. What do you want me to do now? He didn't do that. He embraced his son with him. With an embrace he did not deserve. He decided to come back home and get on rhythm. You and I, if we accept that invitation, God's going to give us that embrace that we don't deserve. He decided to come back home to get on rhythm. Invitation, direction, celebration. I don't know what invitation that maybe you need to accept today, but every single one of us has an invitation that Jesus is trying to give us. But I just have to do something. Remember, God honors effort. Maybe you're thinking, man, I know I've been sitting in this seat 6 months or so. It's great. Glad you're here. Maybe I need to do this thing called serving. Maybe I need to step out in faith. See, there's something different when I activate in my faith and start the serving thing. We all have an invitation. And we all have a call to action. What are you going to do? Let's do this thing together and stay on rhythm. Accept the invitation. Get the direction. And celebrate. How many of you all have been knocked off rhythm in life? Or maybe you're kind of starting to get knocked off now. Or maybe you know a loved one who has got knocked off in their Christ life. And you want them to come back home, come back to Jesus, and have a come back to Jesus moment so he can embrace them. Let's do this thing called life together, but let's do it in rhythm. Accept the invitation, get the direction, and let's celebrate for what God is doing in our life, for what God is doing through for the loved one who's out there who needs Jesus. I just want to encourage you this morning with your eyes closed and your head bowed. If you're here and you don't know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, maybe you just want to rededicate your life because you have kind of gotten off rhythm in your Christ life. It doesn't mean you've gone out and done drugs. Maybe you just slipped up on your Bible reading, on your praying, and you're kind of off rhythm and you want to get back on that rhythm. Right where you're at, I want you to slip your hand up and put it back down. If you've gone off of rhythm in your Christ life and you want to get back on it, you want to extend that invitation, we can do this thing now. Right where you're at, we're just going to pray. All pray together. God can do miracles right in the seat. You don't have to come up to the altar, but the altar is open. But God can do miracles right where you're at right now. And if you know a loved one who is off of rhythm and you want them to come back home like the prodigal son or the prodigal daughter, I want you to raise your hand up in honor of them, and we'll pray. There's several hands going up. Thank you. Several hands going up. We all probably know people. Let's all pray together. Dear God, we just thank you for the invitation that you've granted to all of us, God. God, I pray for the ones that are off course, God, off of rhythm. God, I pray the ones that raised their hand, even the ones that have not raised their hand, God, that want to come back like the prodigal son and want to get back on the rhythm. God, we pray for them. We lift them up, God. God, I pray that you would just give them an invitation right where they're at, God. God, I pray when they accept that invitation, God, you would then give them direction, God. God, you would give them direction on where to go, where to serve, what to do next in their life. God, I pray for the ones that aren't here, God, for the loved ones that are off course, God, off rhythm. God, I pray you would go out there right now, God, and reach your hand out there to them right now, God, and throw an invitation at them right now, God. Pierce their hearts right now, God. God, I pray that you would just give them an invitation, God, and not only an invitation, God, I pray that you would just give them direction, God. God, I pray as we close, God, I pray that you would give us all direction, God. And everything we do in life, God, continually to give us direction, continually to allow us to rely on your Holy Spirit, God. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name.
Let's sing this song.
Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul.
Let's just close with our hands raised up in the air and just worship this morning as we close.
I live for you alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me.
Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a hand this morning. Pastor John, what a wonderful message. Just give him a hand this morning. Yes, amen. Praise the Lord. Don't forget, next Sunday is Easter Sunday. Invite your family, invite your friends. Just to kind of let you know the structure of our message, invite your unsaved loved ones. I'm going to start out the very first part of my sermon is going to be talking about the cross and salvation. Amen. So whoever you invite next Sunday, I'm going to be talking about that, ending up on the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to pray this prayer over you. The Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Let's give the Lord a big hand. May the Lord bless you this week.